Bună seara, doamnelor și domnilor! Vă mulțumim că sunteți alături de noi. Ascultați Radio AVfM, Vocea Europei.
Jó estét, hölgyeim és uraim! Köszönjük figyelmüket! Önök az a Voice Former Rádió Európa hangja műsorát hallgatják.
And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for tuning in. You are listening to a Voice for Men Radio, the voice of Europe. A Voice for Men is the flagship of the men's rights movement. And this show is probably the only one at this point addressing the issues concerning men and boys at a European level. If you ever thought that there's something wrong regarding the state's approach to men and their issues, this is the best place to start. This is the place where feminism gets to be called out on its lies and propaganda, and the state is invited to get out of people's lives. Please consider visiting avoiceformen.com and see how the truth in action sounds like. We are here and we don't plan on leaving anytime soon. And now, Lucian Valsan shall bring us on today's topic.
Feminists and manginas be warned.
While you're listening to this show, bricks of logic may fly out.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Tonight at the Voice of Europe, we'll be talking about the EU. Again. With the risk of sounding like a broken record, the EU simply can't stop from regulating, interfering, and meddling into people's private lives and businesses. As this show reported a few months ago, the EU is attempting to literally stamp out economic freedom from the European Union in the name of equality of outcome between the sexes, but only in the boardrooms, not in the lower layers of work. Basically, turning the feminist wet dream into reality, no matter the consequences. The proposal put forth by Viviane Reding, the Luxembourgian European Commissioner, tasked with forcing feminist policies down the throats of over 500 million people, has been working like a charm, and it was approved by the last committee of the European Parliament. That being said, this proposal will be subjected to vote in the next full session of the European Parliament, which will be after the European elections in May 2014. Under these conditions, the next European elections will be crucial for the very idea of merit in business. Mike Buchanan, the president of the UK political party Justice for Men and Boys and the Women Who Love Them, and the initiator of the Campaign for Merit in Business in Britain, will come to the microphone of the Voice of Europe to talk about the effects of the EU policies on British business and on the rights of men and boys. Justice for Men and Boys is a political party who will be participating in the next British elections and who is currently militating for the rejection of this egregious EU regulation. We will also talk about other aspects of British politics in regards to men and boys, as well as the future of gender politics in Europe and elsewhere. Do you have a question for Mike Buchanan? Do you have a piece of advice on how to further advance the case for the humanity of men and boys in Britain and elsewhere? Call in and engage! I am Lucian Valsan, and this is the Voice of Europe. Alright, we are back on live. Greetings Europe, greetings everyone, wherever you are listening to us right now. This is Lucian Valsan, broadcasting from Cluj-Napoca, Romania. Alongside with me is Hufnagel Pista, broadcasting from Budapest, Hungary, as well as James Huff, our producer, broadcasting from the US. We have a great show prepared for you tonight. Hi there, Hufnagel.
Hi, Lucian, and hi, James, and hi, everyone who listens to our show. Good evening and good afternoon.
Okay, how's been the weather lately?
This week was quite chilly in the morning, however it was sunny during the day, and the good weather is coming back for the weekend, so we have a nice weather night right now.
Oh, that's great. That's totally the opposite as what it has been here. We've had the 2 days in which the temperature has risen up to 27 degrees in Celsius during the day, which is a lot for this period.
But in the same time, we also had days in which it rained, almost like during summer times, I mean, with the huge amounts of water. It was basically a mirrored weather. In the eastern part, it was sunny, it was raining here, and then quite the opposite in the western part. It was sunny and it rained in the eastern part. Very weird, I would categorize the weather in this period, wouldn't you?
Yeah, exactly, but it's autumn, it's usual, so it's normal, I think. It's no extremities this time.
Yeah, that's great, at least that part. Well, I'll have to let everyone know up front, I'm living in a feminist curse. It seems like a feminist had cursed me to live into perpetual technical problems. So even though I have finally changed my graphics card, it might crash during the show. So if I sound weird for several minutes, it might be because I'm waiting for the graphics card to revive thanks to the great driver of a certain corporation that I won't mention. It's such a fucked up driver that not even the technical director of that corporation is capable of responding to my questions. Yeah. Okay, that being said, I think we should move to the news, shouldn't we?
Yes. May I start?
You are listening to AVfM Radio, the voice of Europe. This is the news.
Yes, you may. Hufnagel, you have the floor.
Okay. EU gender quotas are moving forward. The European Parliament's Legal Affairs Committee, the Jury, and the Women's Rights and Gender Equalities, the FEM committees, approved the measure to introduce gender quotas in private companies, a measure initially proposed by the Justice Commissioner Viviane Reding. The joint meeting between the two committees ended with 40 out of combined 55 members voting in favor of the draft legislation, while 9 MEPs voted against the amended legislation and 2 abstained. Evelyn Regner, MEP for the Socialist Alliance and rapporteur for this document, declared after the meeting, "We do not have an exception for family enterprises or specific sectors, but we have strengthened the penalties that member states should apply when companies do not fulfill the directive's requirements." Rodi Kratsa-Tsagoropoulou, co-rapporteur for this document, added that today's vote on the joint report by the Women's Rights and Legal Affairs Committee sends a strong call for EU legislation to step up women's membership and participation in boards of listed companies. What is currently a reality in some EU member states will soon be extended to the single market as a whole and all EU listed companies. Evelyn Regner added that now it is up to the Council to agree a common position so that negotiation between the Council of Ministers and Parliament and co-legislation can start. If this document becomes a law, companies that fail to reach the target of having at least 40% women in their boards by 2020, they will have to explain why to national authorities. If the authorities deem that the companies have not followed transparent and open appointment procedures, they can face penalties such as being excluded from public calls for tenders or fines. 9 EU countries, including Germany and the UK, oppose the measure on the grounds of EU lacking the capacity to enforce such a measure and on grounds of the measure being incompatible with the subsidiarity principle. The next step of the vote is the plenary of the European Parliament, which will happen in the Parliament's next full season after the May 2014 European elections.
Yep.
Very bad news. Women's quota on the move.
Yeah, well, not only it's a bad piece of news, but basically, considering the fact that it is already a relatively majority consensus formed within the governments of the European Union member states, this vote basically means it's a spit in the face, isn't it?
Yeah. I don't... Yeah. But
it's basically a spit in the face. I mean, Angela Merkel said fuck off. Viktor Orban said fucked off. Heck, even David Cameron, who is a very accommodationist with the EU, even he said fuck off. And so many other countries also said, no, absolutely not. The Brussels will not get to dictate this to us. And they're still pushing it.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know what's happening, but we see that coming. So they're pushing it that pretty much hard, and I don't know how to stop them and what to do. If all the single members of the EU are saying no, and then still try to force it.
Someone said once that the EU is basically the new communism. It is power without limit.
Yeah.
And that's what it is. It is power without limit.
Yeah.
Against everyone's wishes, Brussels moves further with this crap. And the only piece of good news in this is that the final vote in the parliament will be after the European elections. And because of that, I would love to point out to the listeners on to go to A Voice for Men and look for my article, List of Feminist MEPs. And if you live in a EU country, look at that list and vote out those people. And I really mean it. In the next parliament, after May 2014, that parliament that will be formed following that election, that voting, will be the one deciding our very economic freedom. For all of us, not just for women, for all of us. Because one should not forget that at the end of the day, this kind of measure harms women as well. Because who is going to trust a female board member if there is always a suspicion that she got there by virtue of her sex and not by virtue of her merit?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
Special clothing, I think. Or a cap. I'm a court woman. Look at me. That's how a real courtman looks like.
Yeah, yeah. That might be a solution on the short run.
of my pussy, or something like that. The T-shirt, or something. I can imagine that they should wear such piece on their body.
Oh, yeah.
Awful. If I would be a woman, I would be ashamed.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the next piece of news, basically the most important for AVFM, is the piece of news of ABC News. Those that are connected with what AVFM does outside of this show, is they already know that ABC is preparing a hit piece against us, which will be viewed by several tens of millions of people. I'm frankly happy that this is going to happen. The show will probably take place late in the night in Europe times, something like 4 a.m. Central European time. So we won't get to see it live, but we will get to see a recording, definitely. ABC News, deep in the underbelly of the internet is a hidden corner known as the Manosphere, a collection of websites, Facebook pages, and chat rooms where men vent their rage and spew anti-women rhetoric. And then they go on and call us a Manosphere blog run by Paul Elam. Of course, ABC News is unable to read properly in English, considering the fact that it's been over 1 year and a half when we just pointed our middle finger to the Manosphere. But anyway, Paul Elam told the ABC News 2020 that while he may not agree with some of the comments that are made on the website, he believes that men are society's victims and need a forum to vent. There has been a change in the world, especially in the last 50 years. Women's roles have changed drastically, he told on 2020. What a lot of us in this area find is that men's roles have not changed very much, and many find now that they have to react. Paul Elam also explained that men leave these comments in the manosphere to get people to listen. It's very much designed to get someone like you to sit down and ask me questions, he told 2020's Elizabeth Vargas. We're addressing a group of problems that this society ignores. Ilham said institutions like marriage and corrupt family courts have become dangerous for men. Marriage has become unsafe ground for men because we have corrupt family courts that practice bias against men and fathers routinely, he told 2020. And men are waking up to this and they don't get a fair deal. Okay, I won't read the rest of the article. Then they invite experts from the Southern Mental Poverty Law Center to give their take. Of course, the Southern Mental Poverty Center, or the SPLC as they call themselves, it's an institution proven to have been financed by people like the RadFem Hub. So I'm not really so sure that the SPLC's quote-unquote experts are really, really relevant in this regard, aren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, nobody, when feminists open their new forum or their new whatever or their new venue, I'm not expecting for the media to invite me to go and say what I think about it. Yet somehow, when the media finds out that, you know, there is a place where feminism is being called out on its lies and propaganda, we suddenly have to call radical feminist Southern Mental Poverty Center's experts to give their take on this? Am I missing something here?
Yeah, awful.
Anyway, I'm looking forward to see the hit piece they did, because I know that this will bring a tremendous amount of extra audience for us, which is a double-edged sword, as a matter of fact, of course we'll get, Paul Elam told me once in a private conversation, I hope he doesn't mind that I reveal this, in this business you'll get support from good people, dissent from equally good people, and dissent from people that are fucked in the head. With this new amount of audience that will definitely come towards us in the following weeks, we'll definitely get new good people and new people that disagree with us, and a lot of new trolls. So be prepared for that. The next piece of news comes from Sweden. I have a lot of news from Sweden. Now, I'm going to pass two links in the chat room, both of them in Sweden. The first one is the original one, Flickr Nafik and Björn Tjänst, The Girls Get a Disservice. And the second one from friateater.se is the critic for the first one. I'm going to read the critic. Bamse inte tillräckligt vänster för Expressen. Bamse is not enough. Is not leftist enough for Expressen. Now, Bamse is a cartoon which, since the 1970s, has spread socialist propaganda to children, and it is now being under severe attack by Expressen. Now, Expressen in Sweden is the British equivalent of The Guardian. The reason that Expressen is attacking these cartoons, which again are cartoons meant to spread socialist propaganda, is because the new character including in the show, Sorkstina, is not gender sensitive enough. Sorkstina, who makes the debut in the latest issue of in the latest episode of Bamse, can be directly harmful to children. The warning comes from the Expressen author Alexandra Sundqvist, who devotes an entire article to show her annoyance over the popular children's magazine's lack of gender perspective. According to Sundqvist, Sorkstina is not a person in its own right because she falls in love with Curious Sork, the series' evil capitalist. Therefore, the new character is doing girls a great disservice, according to the radical communist cultural critic. The alleged sexist character created by the 12-year-old Bamse Bomb is not shared by the author of the character, Clara Wimmer, who wanted Cirque's Tima to highlight a softer side of Cruz's Cirque, who otherwise was often portrayed as uncaring. The criticism that Bamse gets from the left is not unusual. The creator of the world's strongest bear, Rune Andreasson, has attracted attention through activities, including pages in the magazine for children to celebrate the communist Chinese dictator Mao Zedong and spread radical leftist ideas to the young readers. Andreasson, who died in 1999, he probably never anticipated that the current climate, the current reality would run on his life's work in less than two decades after his death. Now, remember, Sweden is a country that has a lot of issues, like real issues, you know. For instance, they have a high rate of innocent people sent to jail on ludicrous sexual offenses charges that have never been proven. Sweden has several Islamic ghettos who have been the main result of their latest policies, and all these things. And one of the most important newspapers in Sweden takes time to talk about a cartoon for children. This is what I mean when I say Sweden is a
dysfunctional society. Ridiculous, you know. And you know, this cartoon was actually a socialist or leftist cartoon, and they do not find it Nazist enough right now, you know, and mm-hmm. it's awful, you know, and generally.
And again, it's a cartoon that was singing praising to Mao Zedong, for crying out loud. So saying that this cartoon is not leftist enough, and that woman again gets a platform on the mainstream media.
Unbelievable, really.
Absolutely unbelievable. And if you think that is unbelievable, now we should remember that Swedish ideologues have called me twice in the last 3 months. They called me a racist. Now let me read something from a Swedish feminist ideologues. Two links, debatt.svt.se, Porrförbund kan vara en väg framåt även för Sverige. A ban on porn could be a way forward for Sweden. Recognize the language, way forward. Also, I'm not going to read that because it has a very weird language and I can't read it verbatim and translate it verbatim. So I'm going to read the critic, which is a little bit simple, from friatider.se. Ung vänster vill förbjuda porr. Men bara för vita män. The young left wants to ban porn, but only for white men. It's a little bit older news in August, but still. Sweden, Johanna Granbon, league director of the young left, recently created a debate on SVT when she openly called for a ban on pornography in Sweden. But it is not porn in general who she wants to outlaw in the union, but only the porn that is directed at white men, end of quote. It was in a post on SVT debate as the young left official last week highlighted the law, the banning through law as a way to stop the, quote, stale attitude towards women, end of quote, that porn allegedly conveys. When the left-wing newspaper Dagens Nyheter followed up the opening lead with an interview with Johanna Granborn, an interview that was not made available online, she revealed, however, that only a certain type of pornography she wants to criminalize, the porn for white men. Porn that caters to men with other skin colors other than white will be, by all accounts, continue to be okay in the youth left league. So even porn produced for women and people of different sexual orientation. There is also a criticism from queer feminist sources, which often indicates that there are standards in regards to critical porn, but it is not the one we want to access without the one produced by the mass industry, which is aimed at white men, Grambon told for Dagens Nyheter. An example of standard critical porn is the film series Dirty Diaries from 2009. The project was based on 13 Swedish radical feminists who got hundreds of thousands of Swedish kronor in the contribution for the from the civil government to record the feminist and anti-racist porn videos. The tax-financed porn films showcased several sex scenes between white women and black men, and one of them is directed by Johanna Rüttel, who previously declared that she will never give birth to a white man, and they call themselves, quote, nigger-loving fetishist bitches, end of quote. In the movie, Rüttel goes around and exposes herself in places where children are present. Now, this is the most infuriating thing that I have ever read on the Swedish media. And go to the third link from Dagens Nyheter, and you will hear them calling themselves nigger-loving fetishist bitches. And well, they call everyone else a racist?
Yeah.
Seriously, Sweden?
That's
serious?
Not standard again. Oh, my God. Unbelievable.
Absolutely unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. I mean, not only they are using KKK-oriented language, not only that they are incredibly racist, but they also get funding from the civil government of Sweden to make porn that caters to this way of thinking.
I downloaded that.
Sweden, go home, you're drunk.
Yeah, really. I downloaded that state supported porn, and that's real weird, real aggressive. At the end there is a scene with two lesbians in a cellar of an industrial building, and it's fucking hard. Actually, I've never seen that much violence in a pornographic movie. It's really sick, and it was sponsored by the state, you know. Awful, awful. It's a tragedy.
Now, again, there are people who are not offended by the idea of having porn sponsored by the state. Now, frankly, I am. I don't consider that the state should sponsor any film whatsoever. Not just porn, any film whatsoever. But let's say for a second that it is okay to subsidize pornography using public funds. But is it really okay to use the taxpayers' money to make pornography made by middle-class, left-wing, racist pricks who also call themselves in racial slurs, like using the N-word and things like that? Is it really that okay? I mean, what's wrong with Sweden?
Yeah.
I mean, what's wrong with Sweden?
Oh, I don't know. Each week you surprise me with news, and it's unbelievable. I don't know how to be the normal life is getting back there, this country. And it's I don't know. It's such a damage this country suffered that it couldn't be turned back. I think.
Absolutely amazing. The reason I chose to put this piece of news now on the show is because I had a little online encounter like 3 weeks ago with a Swedish ideologue who called me a racist when I dared to point out that the Swedish media should indeed go to places like Rosengård, which is the Islamic ghetto near Malmö, and give us some new images from there and new real news from there. And the Swedish ideologue called me a racist. And then I found this piece of news and asked her, now look, now who's the racist? The one who demands a little bit of objective news from the media, or this, which is funded by the state? I mean, seriously. And the sense of proportionality is, I don't know, I would even go so far as to say that most of the journalists in the Swedish mainstream media have lost their moral compass. I would go so far as to argue this.
Yeah.
Absolutely amazing. And the last piece of news that I have prepared, also from Sweden, Dagens Nyheter. Om polisen fälls kan hon förlora jobbet. If the policewoman is convicted, she will lose her job. It's an update on the on that case with the policewoman who was beating a man in the street. Three questions from from the Dagens Nyheter crime reporter Stefan Lisinski, very Swedish, on the indictment police in Stockholm who beat a man repeatedly with batons. Is it surprising that the policewoman is being prosecuted? No, it's not surprising, but it is unusual. Only 1.6% of complaints against the police are prosecuted. In this case, there was unusually strong evidence in the form of the film showing police intervention. Is it obvious that the police will now be folded? No, she denies the charges, and statistics show that courts often free police officers accused of violence in the service. The court must determine whether she was using too much force against him, who several witnesses say telling that this was the case. Although the film shows that that he was calmed at the intervention, the court also assessed how the police understood the situation at the time. If she is convicted, she could lose her job? Well, if she is convicted of assault, yes, she may lose her job. But the prosecutor also indicted for having been negligent in its proceedings. And if she is only found guilty of misconduct, she has more opportunity to be able to continue working as a police officer. The position will be determined only after the case is tried in court.
Hmm.
I mean, really, how... You don't have to be a prosecutor. You don't have to be a person who has high studies in law to just look at the clip and assess
what happened. Yeah.
I mean, seriously, how complicated can that be?
Awful. Awful.
I mean, I don't. I can't understand. Now, let me find, well, I'm trying to find, but I'm no longer able to find it, the original clip. Anyway, the last piece of news, I think it comes from Germany. Hufnagel, I think you had a piece of news from Germany, didn't you?
Yes, another step forward democracy, yes. So,
go ahead.
As the Frankfurter Allgemeine Zeitung reports, in the state of Rhineland-Palatinate, the ruling coalition of Social Democrats and Greens have passed a law to manipulate local elections. According to the law, the ballot paper for local elections must contain the following quote for German Constitution: men and women are equal before the law. Further, it must list the ratio of men and women for each party, as it was 2 months before the vote, as well as the sex ratio of those candidates nominated in the top half of the suggested list of each party. This is a none too subtle hint to voters that they ought to vote for more female candidates. It is also intended to shame those parties who dare to have more male candidates. This suggestion is, of course, entirely fallacious. The Constitution only mandates Gleichberechtigung, equal rights, not Gleichstellung, equal standing for, or equal outcome. But in public disclosure, for two entirely different and incompatible terms are frequently conflated. It is hard to say how successful this attempt at influencing voters will be, but even the threat of possibly being seen as anti-woman may induce parties to nominate more female candidates, though taking politics one more step away from meritocracy. But no content with this, the new law also contains the following passage. Women and men should be equally represented in the representative councils, gender parity. When assembling the list of suggested candidates, the parties and voters groups are advised to strive for gender parity. This doesn't forbid parties from having lists that violate gender parity, but at the very least strongly discourages it. It creates the definite suggestion that there is something suspicious and possibly illegitimate about the party that nominates more men than women. This of course entirely ignores the fact that many more men than women are interested in participating in politics. But pesky things like uncomfortable effects are conveniently ignored by the ruling femocrats. It's also rather arbitrary that this measure singles out sex as the sole characteristic deserving of such treatment. If gender parity is so desirable, then why not also educational and intelligence parity? Surely we won't want to deprive uneducated or unintelligent people of representation. Why not also proportional representation based on religion, race, ethnicity, income level, marital status, number of children, sexual orientation, and a host of other categories? If we apply this principle consistently enough, we won't even have to vote anymore. We can just determine who gets to be the in councils or parliaments based on group membership. And while we are at it, then we can also do it away with such old-fashioned notions as individual achievements and merit. Right now, this law only affects local elections in one Bundesland. But similar attempts have also been made in Baden-Württemberg. Right now, we can still hope that the laws like this will be struck down as unconstitutional. So I'm very optimistic about that prospect. I'm not very optimistic about that prospect. But if they stand as they are, they could be a mighty weapon in the hands of those parties who already have a higher ratio of female members or internal women's quotas. In any case, this is another step on the path of absolute feminist rule, femocracy. For while feminists have infiltrated all major parties, the chains of constitutional democracy still hold them to some extent, can only be loosened gradually. But in the long run, only popular opinion can avert the course we are currently on. Thanks to a PR debacle that is modern feminism, a recent study in Germany, commissioned by Women's Magazine no less, has found that 64% of men are fed up with what passes for gender equality these days, and 76% say that they have not been discriminated against based on their gender. This vast number of people is currently being ignored by all major parties in Germany. Instead, the powerful feminist forces in politics, the media treat them either as confused and helpless manlings who have been overwhelmed by all the progressiveness of our age and who need to be re-educated to join the feminist cause, or else as dangerous Neanderthal machos who need to be put in their place. We can only hope that soon enough some party will wake up and realize the great number of potential voters it could gain if only it had to openly oppose the feminist hegemony. Until that happens, things are going to get worse. I see that as it's very, very true story. Yeah. Femocracy is coming in Germany as well, and hopefully the Germans will wake up and do something against that, because it's very bad for Germany and Europe.
Yeah, well, what I find is stupid is, it sounds to me, and I don't know, maybe you know, and maybe Jan wrote that article, maybe Jan will call and clarify even further, but it sounds to me more like a bullying-oriented measure, just like the EU does. You know, the EU forced all the internet websites that can be accessed from the European Union, that is, the entire internet, to bring us those cookies warnings, you know, just to show that the EU is strong and has some kind of legitimacy and things like that, you know. And this seems to me the case with this piece of legislation as well. Let's just show the general public how powerful feminists are, so they're going to bully the voters. And yeah, they're just gonna remind them, including in the in the voting booth, what they have to do and who they have to vote. That's even worse than the fraudulent elections in 1946 Romania, where when the commies won. I mean, at least in that one square meter in the voting booth, you were left alone. Nobody was watching. But now they bring propaganda, including in the voting booth.
Yeah. Awful.
Absolutely stupid. Okay, these were the news, and I think we should move on to the music break, and then we'll have Mike Buchanan, the president of the UK political party Justice for Men and Boys. We have a lot of questions for him, and I'm sure the audience also has a lot of questions for him. For the music break, we will be listening to a song from a heavy metal band from Spain. The song belongs to the album Sociedad Enferma, issued in 2006. The name of the song we'll be listening is also Sociedad Enferma, which means sick society. So, Arai Sociedad Enferma. All right, we are back. We have listened to Aray Sociedad Enferma, great metal band from Spain. We have our guest on the line. We'll be talking tonight a lot about British politics and generally about ways to further what we're aiming to straight into the mainstream. So without further ado, let's welcome Mike Buchanan. Mike, welcome to the Voice of Europe.
Thank you very much, Lucian. Nice to be on.
That's great. How's it going in there in Britain with the weather, I mean?
it's like living in California, to be honest with you, Lucian.
Well, I don't know how is it to be living in California, so I guess I'll have to agree. All right. Now, whilst I'm trying to be a little bit entertaining, the issues up front are incredibly serious, unfortunately.
Yes.
I mean, in many days, I wish I weren't doing this show and doing something more pleasant. But hey, this is what it is. What it is. So before going anywhere else, we know that there is a significant overlap between the audience of this show and the audience of other A Voice for Men radio shows. However, there are many individuals who listen to this show regularly more than others for whatever reason. So that being said, please tell our audience a few things about your political party and about your activity in general.
Okay, well, we launched in February of this year, so that's about 7 or 8 months ago. And we're planning to contest the top 30 Conservative marginal seats in the 2015 general election. And our strategy is at this stage to fight the most anti-male party at each general election, with a view to the parties starting to compete with each other to have any damn concern about men and boys at all, which at the moment they don't. And under David Cameron, who became party leader in 2005 and prime minister in 2010, the Conservatives, to their eternal shame, have followed every policy agenda of the preceding three Labour administrations. And in some areas, they've even gone further. So, for example, at the moment, there's plenty of women being appointed to FTSE 100 boards as a result of the government's threat of legislated gender quotas. Now that came in as a result of Cameron, as soon as he came to power, appointing a socialist peer, Lord Davis, to write a report into how to persuade companies to what they call voluntarily take on more women on their boards. Whenever they use the word voluntarily, I'm sorry, I just can't help but laugh.
It sounds like the EU's notion of voluntarily. Yeah. You can do whatever you want as long as you do exactly what we want.
Exactly so. So one of Lord Davis's key recommendations was that if the FTSE 100 hadn't reached 25% female representation on the board by 2015, the government should consider imposing legislated gender quotas. Now, the year before the Davis report, 2010, just 13%, that's 13% of new FTSE director appointments were women. And the year after the Davis report, that was last year, 55% of new FTSE 100 directors were women. It's so more than a quadrupling.
And I guess the threat worked.
Well. There's a number of dimensions to this, which we'll go on to later. The FTSE, I mean, I ran a thing called the Campaign for Merit in Business, which I think we're going to come to on at some point.
Yes.
But the extraordinary thing is that certainly the FTSE 100, it not only has shown no resistance to the government threats, it's actively complicit. It's doing this stuff enthusiastically. Mm-hmm. And perhaps we'll come on to that later. But going forward a bit, in February of this year, we launched the party. With a view to contesting 30 seats in May 2015, and we're on track on the funding front, and we have four candidates already fully funded. So it's all going very well. I mean, I was delighted the other day to see that a Guardian journalist, Ali Fogg, wrote a blog piece trying to absolutely, you know,
Yeah, we'll talk about it really, because it's been a while since I had enough laughter at his blog piece.
I'm personally grateful for the exposure, because at the end of the day, people can read the sort of assassinations of our consultation document, of me personally, everything else. But they go and look at these. They go and look at our websites, our blogs, and think, hang on, there's something in this. And we've actually had a lot of supportive comments, and mostly from people I've never heard of. It's not by any means just supporters. There is a move about, you know, people are getting this stuff.
Well, I guess time will tell about these things. Now, going back a little bit to that company thing, as I said in the news section, Vivian Redding's march towards stamping out the economic freedom, not only in the UK, but in the entire European Union, in 28 unfortunate nations, all in the name of feminism, her proposal is working like charm. The last joint committee meeting in the European Parliament in October 14th voted overwhelmingly in favor of the position to introduce the arm of the state into the company's recruitment process. This is egregious. Now, I want to ask you, what do you think about this? And are you surprised that it is working smoothly so far? And how do you think the UK government will react to this? I mean, formally at least, David Cameron opposes Brussels to meddle in and interfere and regulate these kinds of things in the UK. But will this position go on in the UK government in the near future? Now, what is your view towards this aspect, towards not only the British government trying to meddle into private business, but Brussels doing it for 28 nations? What's your take on
that? I think the objection of the government is not so much to, you know, quotas, because that's its own policy direction, but it's to the imposition from the EU. So if you like, it's an issue of power. It's not an issue of, I mean, it's the same direction of travel. It's been the direction that we've been going in for years, but it's taken the Conservatives to threaten gender quotas. As far as Vivian Redding's concerned, I mean, the woman is vile. And, of course, she's on record as saying that she wants a United States of Europe. In fact, that was the front page of her website just a few months ago. Of the British political parties, only UKIP seems to criticise feminist manipulation of the EU with any frequency. Although I know that there's one Conservative MEP, Marina Yannakoudakis, fine English name, who opposes gender quotas for corporate boards, at the EU level. And she occasionally gets a column inch or two, but it's very weak opposition.
Yeah, well, Marina Yannakoudakis is a Greek MEP from the Europeans for Conservatives and Reformation, something like that, ECR.
I'm sorry, Lucian. She's actually a British MEP.
Of Greek ethnicity.
She's married to a Greek guy.
Mm-hmm, I see.
Yeah.
Well, but then again, I've listened to her, and we reported about her position in this show when this was first time discussed in this late spring, early summer. And when she expressed her position in the committee, that at that point was something like, look, we all want more women on boards, but basically her opposition was, please exempt the small and medium enterprises, the SMEs. But her opposition wasn't about all companies, as opposed to the German MEPs who went full force and said, now look, our German constituency would never agree to that, so no.
Yeah.
That is what I call opposition. Marina Yannakoudakis more or less is an accommodationist, you know. It sounds great, but let's tone it down a little bit. That's accommodationist language.
I completely agree. And in fact, when I was before I formed the party and I was running a campaign for American business, I engaged with House of Lords and House of Commons inquiries. And one of the things that absolutely appalled me was that there was, both in the inquiries and in the final reports, although there were, you know, Conservative MPs and Conservative peers on the committee, they were all, what, as you call it, accommodationists. You know, in the case of the House of Commons report, there was not a single line, it's a very long report, there was not a single line that I could recognize as being traditional conservative right of center thinking. The whole thing could have been written by a feminist society.
Yes, yes, and this is the same case in the European Parliament as well. I wrote at the end of March for a Voice for Men the list of feminist MEPs, and I divided them by country. And with the minimal exceptions, the members of the European Parliament from every single country tend to vote in favor of anything the feminists say. I mean, there are very little opposition. I mean, I even found members of the EFD, which is Nigel Farage's group, voting in favor. Of course, only one or two of them, but it's still, I mean, even there. We get this impression that, you know, in the European Parliament there is a lot of diversity. You know, it's the Socialist Alliance, is the EPP, is the ALDE. When you look at how they vote on feminist economic issues, they all vote the same.
Yes, they do.
There is literally no difference. They're merging into one single political party.
Yeah, I mean, that's exactly right. I mean, the Conservatives have just waved the white flag. You know, if you look back to people like Margaret Thatcher, you know, she would have had none of this. But, time moves on, and the Conservatives, I mean, it's our view that at some point the Conservatives will implode with a general election defeat, if not in 2015, then in 2020. And then the business of starting a proper right-of-center party can start again.
Yeah, well, I hope you're right about that, because, yeah, definitely. I mean, Margaret Thatcher is on the record for saying that feminism is poison, and boy, how right she was. Now, you talked about the campaign for merit in business in Britain, and you've launched it. It was more or less as a reaction at the European Commission's proposal that we talked about it. Now, please tell us more about it. How is it working? What are the results so far? How was it received by the companies or by the public at large? Things like that.
Well, that's a very interesting point. Well, one of the reasons, this is about 18 months ago or so, I guess, I was already running the Anti-Feminism League, and I thought, you know, I've really got to... It's too broad brush, and, you know, organizations like A Voice for Men are doing great work. So is there perhaps one or two battles that I can really focus on? And there was increasing evidence that from a number of countries that when the proportion of women, I mean, Norway in particular, of course, when the proportion of women on corporate boards is increased, corporate performance declines. And it's not so much a gender effect, it's an inexperience effect. And you would expect exactly the same thing with any, you know, cohort. But of course, I mean, I think the German guy was saying a bit earlier, the only cohort that ever gets put forward in this way is women. You know, we don't sort of say, you know, let's have equal representation for short people or one-legged people or deaf people. It's always women every time. So. Yeah, I mean, as far as businesses were concerned, I mean, that was a big disappointment, because I was hoping that big businesses would appreciate some support in fighting off the government, like the government policy direction. But it turned out that almost without exception, they were perfectly keen on it. And I think there's a number of reasons for that. One is that there's almost a Faustian pact, as I see it, between government and big business in particular, where... you know, and certainly this is true of the Conservative-led coalition, they very much angle legislation to encourage women into work and out of the home. So that, as far as big business is concerned, that's wonderful in two regards. It provides a bigger pool of labor, which depresses wage rates. And it also creates a good deal more demand.
Mm-hmm. That's something like, you know, the feminist face of corporatism, isn't it?
Yes. So I mean, big business, at least in the UK at the moment, just is doing absolutely nothing to fight it. I mean, you know, quite the opposite. They are part of the problem.
Yes, and you brought the example of Norway. Well, there was a tremendous documentary made about Norway. It was made by the state television, the NRK. The series is called Yar Nevask, Brainwash, and especially in the first episode, Likestillingsparadoxet, the gender equality paradox, there is there the former minister of affirmative action in Norway, Kristin Mille, who also explains what you said, that is, you know, there is a difference in experience, not necessarily a difference in gender, but she also brought in there the point that no matter how much the government tries these kinds of things, at least in her experience in Norway, once the particular program was done and things like that, all the numbers came back to normal as they were before introducing the measure. Now, is it the case in Britain as well, or you haven't seen it yet happening?
Well, as I say, the thing that's driving women onto FTSE 100 boards is the threat of quotas in 2015, so that's still moving in that direction. But interestingly, Norwegian companies reacted to the legislated gender quotas in some quite interesting ways. Some of them. Now, I don't know anything about Norwegian legal structures for companies, but some of them, if you like, went into different legal forms, which meant that they weren't subject to the gender quotas. But I think most of the major companies remained of the legal forms, so they had to appoint women. And they took what I guess was, you know, what you might reasonably think was a very low-risk solution to the problem, which was to appoint plenty of women as non-executive directors. And you might think that didn't have an impact, but we have three longitudinal studies about the impact of the gender quotas in Norway, and they all show declines in financial performance. So even as non-executives, it's the case. But the issue for us is that it's perfectly well understood, and it has been for years, you know, why it is that men dominate, for example, the top of big businesses. It's something that, you know, something that I've related so often, Lucian, that sometimes I think I'll go insane if I do it again. But I'll have a go if you like. About 4 or 5 years ago, there's about 7 or 8% of the FTSE 100 directors were women. Again, nearly always non-executive directors as they are today. I mean, that's the pattern. But Catherine Hacking in the year 2000 published a paper on something called preference theory. And her research basically showed something very, very interesting. And it was that while 4 in 7 British men are work-centered, only 1 in 7 British women is work-centered. So on a major company, you would expect a 4-to-1 split on gender, wouldn't you? I mean, it's just really basic.
Because it's the desire.
But that's if like all else being equal, but all else is not equal. Now, if you throw in the UK at least, that about 2/3 of private sector employees are men, and men in the UK have traditionally dominated the professions most likely to lead the boardroom, in particular finance, you would expect on the grounds of merit, hard work, professional experience and so on, if you add those three together, you come up with a figure of I think a bit more than 95%. So even sort of 10, 15 years ago, you could say women were overrepresented. And all that's happening is that you know, on the basis of merit and hard work and so on, all that's happening is that the existing overrepresentation of women is accelerating. And it's exactly It's exactly the point that the German guy was making about the difference between equality of opportunity and equality of outcome. And people just do not get that. You ask 10 people in the street and they will tell you that, you know, if there's only a small number of women on FTSE 100 boards, that's because of discrimination, glass ceiling, blah, blah, blah. And they've never heard any other narrative.
Yes. Now, obviously, your political party were going to bring the truth one way or the other. Now, you said that your political party is going to stand in the next elections. That will be in 2015. And since it's a new party, that's obviously you're going to be in perpetual campaign until then. So please tell us a little bit about how the message of justice for men and boys has been received in Britain by the opposition, that is the feminist, and the society in general, and particularly by the constituencies which your political party aims to contest.
Yeah, well, the feminists, you know, are doing what they do. They throw accusations of misogyny and you know, and sexism, blah blah blah. And you know, and I always say to them, look, you know, can you point me to one sentence in any of my books or blogs or anything that shows I'm misogynist? And of course, they never can, but it doesn't stop them. You know, I mean, at the end of the day, feminism, and gender feminism in particular, I'd say, is it's a faith position, and it's therefore utterly immune to rational argument. I mean, some of the exchanges I've had with feminists, including on Ali Blog's two recent pieces, it's almost like debating with a bad-tempered child. You know, I mean, some of these people, you know, I mean, I've owned more intelligent houseplants.
Yeah, and I can definitely relate to these kinds of experiences. And again, you're debating with British feminists. You should try debating with Swedish feminists, and it's 10 times worse. Now, I've seen, and you already mentioned in the beginning of this interview, that the People's Republic of Not-So-Free-Thought blogs, that is the mouthpiece of Atheism Plus, has published an article written by a typical middle-class left-wing prick that writes for The Guardian. And his criticism in there, I read the article and the comments, is mainly directed at you personally, that's an ad hominem, even though he claims to criticize the policy proposals of Justice for Men and Boys. Is that the usual deal that you get from the opposition, just random incoherent ramblings with nothing even close to a rational thought? That's the best that they can come up with?
Yeah, it's an interesting one. I'm actually very grateful to the guy that he did it, Lucian, because no right-of-center bloggers or journalists will go near us. So it's kind of ironic that to get this exposure, it has to come through a very left-wing blogger and journalist on The Guardian as well. But no, we've had perfectly amicable email exchanges, and I really don't care about the personal attacks, Lucian. I think it shows our critics in a bad light, and you know, the more vicious they get, calling me evil and or the policies evil, you know, I just say bring it on. Because it is so disproportionately ridiculous that I just keep calm through it, and he is. I mean, the guy in question is he's actually one of these people who engages with people who keep their cool. I mean, some bloggers like their commentators could just blow up all the time, but I learned a long time ago that I get far further by remaining calm, and you know, so that's what I've done here. And as I say, it's you know, there's been plenty of exposure. Within 10 minutes of the piece coming out, I had a link to it on my blog, and I'm just delighted at the exposure, quite frankly.
I see. In the 2015 election, your political party will be contesting up to 30 conservative marginals, as you put it.
Yes.
And you said you're going to do this because you said there that under David Cameron, the party has been at least as anti-male as the free preceding Labour administration, and that's saying something. Frankly, I couldn't agree more with that position. But is this the only reason you're targeting these constituencies? To the extent that you can reveal the strategy, please tell our audience, why do you think this is a successful strategy? I mean, why not go to the Labour constituencies or Lib Dem, if they have any?
Okay, no, well, I mean, time will tell if it's successful, of course, and if it's not, then we'll do something different. But It would be too easy to target Labour seats, but as you say, the Tories are as anti-Mel as Labour. So we thought there might be an element of intrigue in this. I worked for the Conservatives for 2 years, from 2006 to 2008, as a consultant. And people might think, what in God's name is somebody who worked for Conservatives doing campaigning against them? So that created a bit of intrigue. But I go back to the point that the Conservatives will implode at some point. It's just a question of when. This country will go off a cliff, you know, with another, you know. We were making a certain point there. But as far as future elections are concerned, we'll take each as it comes. So, for example, I'm actually encouraged that the guy from The Guardian has done his two pieces, and the latest one is really rather interesting. It's his own 10-point proposal. Manifesto, if you like, because somebody said in the comments, you know, it's all very well criticizing Buchanan, but just what would you do? And you know, he's a very intelligent guy, although he's wrong on nearly everything. and so he rose to the challenge. I'm delighted to say, and he put up a 10-point manifesto, which again I put straight on our blogs, and there's some really interesting stuff in there. So it's kind of ironic, but if it takes somebody from the left to get this conversation going, I'm all for it.
I see. Why I think the strategy might turn out to be successful is because the older voters and the traditional voters of the Tory are how do I put it, disgruntled with new direction that the Tories are having, and a lot of votes are now going towards alternatives. So that, you have intelligently picked the marginals, that might be a strategy.
Most of them, if they're going anywhere, are going to UKIP. UKIP are getting some very interesting polling ratings at the moment. It's taken 20 years to get there, but they are changing the face of British politics. And I hope in time that we'll do the same.
Yep. Now I can really understand and relate why. How do I love to call them, the Guardianistas, the far left? Yeah. I understand why they don't like you. But why are leftists in general so upset about your proposal and even about the existence of this political party? I mean, shouldn't they be happy that the Tories have more competition? I mean, it's clear that the Tories are disintegrating right now. And the left should be dancing of joy right now, wouldn't they? I mean, why are they so upset?
Well, I mean, part of it is that, I mean, our consultation document, which is online, has a lot of things which are socially conservative, so they get very offended by some of that. Changes to family law, abortion law reform, benefits to single mothers, all this kind of stuff. So they hate that. But at the moment, understandably, Lucian, they don't see us as a credible threat to the Tories. But we've only been around for 7 months, and the two main parties have been around for more than a century, so that's hardly surprising. But they also hate that if we get some traction, that in 2015, if we make a good showing there, and I think we will, that in 2020 we'll make more waves. I mean, one of the things that surprised us in February, I'd really struggled to get any sort of media coverage of our campaigns, but as soon as we established the political party, the BBC were very interested. And I think I had 15 or more interviews and a couple of the Jeremy Vine show at least has 6 or 7 million listeners, and the Woman's Hour is a stalwart of feminist broadcasting. So we actually had something there, but we haven't yet made much of a mark on and in the print media, but I think that's coming. I really do think that's coming.
Okay, now we talked about the reactions from the leftists. Now let's talk a little bit about the reactions from individuals that are, I don't know, more liberal Democrat oriented or modern Tory voters. And I say modern Tory voters and I see them as a separate category than those that used to vote for people like Margaret Thatcher in the past. So
yes.
I say modern Tory voters and Lib Dems are virtually indistinguishable, in my opinion. Now, of course, I could be wrong, you know, better than me in this regard. But what were the reaction from these kinds of individuals who are not necessarily on the line with the Guardianistas, but are still some more or less opposed to what things used to be or what you stand for? What was the reaction from these kinds of individuals?
Well, I think I'd say that these modern, if you like, you know, the people who like Cameron, you know, his sort of followers, they're still to the right of the Lib Dems. I mean, Lib Dems in many areas are to the left of Labour. You know, they are really not a centrist party in any sense. So, you know, you take issues like gender on boards, you know, and they are very much keen on that. And in fact, the business secretary is a guy called Vince Cable, who's on record as saying that if he were ever prime minister, he would have a 50% cabinet. You know, his cabinet would be 50% female. And he's very much one of the key drivers of more women in boardrooms. And along with Cameron and others, he was saying some outrageous things about a year ago. I mean, prior to Campaign for American Business really kicking off, if you put more women on your boards, your profit would increase by 50%. I mean, just crazy, crazy stuff.
Anyway, no.
I'm going off at a tangent again, but to go back to your point, I mean, the Lib Dems, as I say, to my mind, they're in the same camp as Labour, if not even more left-wing. The moderate Conservatives like some of our stuff and not others. But I think the traditional Conservative voters, the people like myself who voted for Margaret Thatcher three times, probably is our core supporter base. And something that always surprises people is that we're getting female supporters and indeed donors to the party, because and these are very often but not always quite traditionally minded women who see the devastation wrought on the nuclear family by the state for the last 20 or 30 years, and they. And it tends to, there's a quite an interesting difference between our female supporters and most of our male supporters. A lot of our male supporters are interested in us, in supporting us, because politically they think we're about justice and meritocracy and so on. But almost all the female supporters and donors share one thing in common. There are one or two exceptions, but virtually all of them share one thing in common, and that's that they've been brought to support us because of personal experiences in life. And now this is true of quite a few of the men, but these are women, let's say, who can't see their grandchildren because they have a spiteful former daughter-in-law who stops them, and or they've had sons commit suicide, sometimes young sons who couldn't get jobs because, you know, everything is
because
so feminized these days.
And they've
joined up enough dots to realize that something really pretty horrible is going on.
Yeah, and there is a feminist talking point that they always bring up: patriarchy hurts men too. Now, the problem with that kind of point is that patriarchy doesn't exist. but here's something that does exist, and it is true: feminism hurts women too.
It does
now,
hugely.
Yes, it does hugely. Now, from now on, I'm gonna open the calling lines. I'm gonna ask the audience to start calling in. The calling number from outside of the United States is 001-310-388-9709. From the U.S., 310-388-9709. And one can also Skype in if you are listening through the Blog Talk Radio interface. There is a little Skype button right next to the telephone number written in the listening window. Now, we have Oz from the United Kingdom on the line, and we're going to bring him first. Oz, welcome to the Voice of Europe.
It's good to be on again.
Hello.
Hello, Oz.
Hello, as another fellowman from the UK, I just want to say actually the weather's been horrible in Wiltshire. It's been raining the whole bloody time, you liar. Now we've got the simple stuff off the chests of us collectively. On to the more dark stuff. Will you be supporting the NHS if you get into power? And secondly, why on earth do you think that so many young people I run into can't perceive anything other than patriarchy is real?
Right. Sorry, shocking. I didn't quite catch the first bit. You said, will we support the NHS with that?
Yeah.
Well, the NHS, we've actually had a lot to say about the NHS, because we think that the feminization of the NHS in the last 30 or so years is the root cause of so many problems. I mean, 70% of medical students today are women.
I know that quite well.
But so many parts of the NHS are in crisis, the fundamental reason, which has been admitted in Parliament, but no one does anything about it, is that female doctors are different to male doctors. They're as a group, they're far more likely to quit the profession altogether because they're more likely to have a partner who can finance that wonderful option. They're far more likely to work part-time, whether or not they have kids. They're far, far less likely to be willing to work on social hours, and they're far less willing to work in the really stressful environments such as A&E. So if you add all that in together, I should also throw in that it costs £250,000 to finance doctors' training, and men in the UK pay 72% of the income tax. So if you throw all that in together, the policy of driving up the proportion of female medics is just insane. I'm not sure that answered your question. I'm sorry, the second question was, sorry, have I answered it or?
You have near enough. The NHS is in a terrible situation at the moment, and it is because of the 69% female doctors that take an ungodly amount of time off. Some would think they were school teachers.
Yeah. Yes. but of course, it's a pattern across.
It's not enough that a socialized healthcare system is working badly because it is socialized. But on top of that, you add a lot of doctors who take a lot of time off, and there you have a lot of queues in the emergency room. I mean, I talked about this issue with an expat, a British expat, and believe it or not, there are quite a lot of them here in Romania. And I've talked to some of them, and they said that our crappy healthcare system actually works better than the NHS in many UK areas, precisely because at least here the doctors show up at work.
My local GP surgery is closed at weekends, you know, so people have to take time off work, you know, at financial loss, so as to go and see the doctor. So the doctors won't work the weekends. And a GP in the UK, an average GP in the UK today, takes over £104,000. Very, very few are ever struck off for incompetence. It's the public sector, after all, so incompetence isn't a problem. It's probably an asset, isn't it? I shall get some emails about that. But at the end of the day, you know, all these sectors which are feminized because of it's not a gender issue, but it's mainly down to work ethic, and it's certainly true of the education sector as well. The more feminized they are, the more mediocre they are, the less client-oriented they are, and the more taxpayers' money they take. It's a very vicious circle.
Yeah, it is. Okay, Oz, if you can and want, please stay on the line. We're going to also bring John from the United States. We know that the United States is also moving gradually, progressively, like a disease, towards an NHS-oriented healthcare system. Let's see what he thinks about it. John, welcome to the Voice of Europe.
Thank you, Lucian. Hello, Mike. How are you doing?
I'm very good, thank you. And you?
Very good. I'm okay. And Oz?
It's good to hear you, John.
Good, good. And, of course, Hufnagel as well. My question for Mike is, obviously, he has a big job ahead of him. He is breaking probably some new ground in his country, and he is facing a lot of challenges. What I'm wondering is, what does he think his biggest challenge, the most difficult thing he'll have to overcome in order to succeed?
I think it'll be getting exposure in mainstream print media. That's our number one obstacle at the moment.
You just have to continue pissing off the newspapers.
I'm sorry?
You just have to keep on pissing off the newspapers, then you'll get enough exposure.
Well, indeed. So you know, I think we have to sort of take a leaf out of AVFM's book in a sense and just kick up some dust. You know, the idea that we're going to, you know, at the end of the day, this is a revolution we have to have. We aren't going to do it by gentle debate with the major parties, all of whom are committed to feminist agendas. It's not going to happen. The way I sometimes think of it is you know, the direction of travel, it's like a steam train going in the direction of travel, and you can try and engage with it, but it's like throwing tennis balls at the train. You know, you kind of have to, I mean, the analogy we have is that, you know, we're every 5 years at a general election, you have the opportunity to put a concrete block on the tracks. And that's what we'll do. Or we'll work our damnedest to do that. I mean, I just don't see a better strategy. But if one comes along, then we'll do that.
Speaking about the printed media, now I remember that there was an MRA, an openly MRA, or at least an anti-feminist, writing for, I think it was Mail Online. His name was Peter Lloyd.
Peter Lloyd.
Wouldn't he be an asset to get you some media exposure outside of the BBC hours on the radio? Because you know, those can be accessed all over the world as opposed to the BBC radio hours, who are harder to find in podcast format.
No, Peter Lloyd is a very talented young, I think mid to late 20s maybe, writer, very, very talented. He's done some quite extraordinary pieces for Mail Online on male victims of domestic violence and a number of other areas. But he is one of these people who would not self-identify as an anti-feminist.
Hello?
Hello? Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes.
Yes, we can.
So, I've met him a couple of times, and he just does not, I don't think he's a terribly political guy. And perhaps like a lot of younger than me, I'm 55, they kind of don't get the political angle, you know, the whole, you know, why feminism is driving so much. And it's something that mystifies lots of people, because they, you know, the average person in the street, man or woman, thinks feminism is about gender equality. And they've never heard anything else. I mean, in 40 years in the UK, there hasn't been a mainstream TV, radio, or newspaper, or periodical piece actually telling the truth about gender feminism, that it's a hate-driven female supremacy movement. I mean, that would be taken as a crazy statement by most people today.
Yes, there's a great way to sum it up. There's a philosophical truth that if you say we want to stop violence against women, you're excluding violence against children, men, animals, and everything else available. Yeah. When you say we want to protect cats, we mean only cats and exclude everything else. So for the equality of women it's the equality of women and no one else.
Yeah.
And that's what feminism has been pushing for several years.
Indeed, it's why we have a Minister for Women and Equalities. I mean, it's you couldn't make this stuff up.
Yeah, a Minister for Women and Equalities. I mean, to me, that sounds like Ministry for White People and Anti-Racism. and I mean that seriously. I mean, it makes no sense whatsoever. Now, I would want to ask, now I'm reading your proposal document, and one of your proposals is to create a ministry for men as well.
Yeah.
Now, my question would obviously be, is why not just repeal the Ministry for Women and get on with this gendered nonsense in the government?
Okay. It was something that we seriously considered, because, you know, at the end of the day, I was thinking, oh my God, there's going to be money involved in this. But at the end of the day, even if the Minister for Women and Equality's role was dropped altogether, the state would still be doing things. It would just be doing things on, you know, under the radar, as it normally does. And the vast majority of the discriminations against men, you know, happen. I mean, some of them are from legislation, but a lot of it is you know, comes from all sorts. You know, there are just so many feminists and so many positions in government in the state.
Yeah, they come from governmental practice more than the legislation. Yeah.
And there was an interesting example the other day that Peter Lloyd is challenging his local gym about women-only, mm-hmm. I think it's sports sessions or gym sessions. And about a year ago, I challenged my local my local swimming pool over the same issue. And they first of all said, well, they had these women-only sessions because in some religions it was forbidden for women to bathe with the opposite gender, and I don't
right.
think we need to name the
religion. So let's appease the religion of peace by fucking around with everyone else. Really?
Indeed. And so I said, well, my understanding, if it's a religion I'm thinking of, that also bans men from bathing with women as well. So I don't quite, you know. So you should have men-only sessions as well. So anyway, so they came up with one thing after another, and eventually the manager, the poor guy, was obviously losing the will to live. And he admitted to me that the real reason that the centre, it's a publicly run swimming pool, the real reason that they have women-only sessions is that a key government grant that they get is dependent upon them offering women-only sessions and only women-only sessions. So now I'm sure there's no legislation there, but it's just kind of how it's just the manipulation of the system that.
Well, it's the manipulation
that
of the legislation that says let's ass-kiss every area where we deem that there is an underrepresented sex, and then the discrimination comes from practice because we're gonna just look where women are the underrepresented sex and do everything we can, including breaking the natural rights of individuals, and we're gonna just ignore everything else. It's so transparent.
But to go back to your original question, Lucian, sorry, I went on a bit of a tangent again. But you asked about why didn't we just seek to drop the Minister for Women? And the reason we want a Minister for Men is that would be a point of focus. So people could then say, do you know what, something that's happened at work, it could be one of 100 things, couldn't it? I'm going to write to my local paper, and I'm going to send a copy to the Minister for Men, and all of a sudden it would be a point of focus, because at the moment there is no point of focus in government for disgruntled mm-hmm. men to go to.
I see. Now, my next question in this regard would be: is the state really trustable to manage this thing in a proper manner? Now, I would argue that it isn't, because who is going to guarantee that particular ministry would not be led by a male version of Harriet Harman, for instance? Who can guarantee that?
Yeah. No, it's a very good question, but I think there'd be public outrage if that happened. If it was a man who just, I mean, I think that would actually be a catalyst for more anger and more activism, if it was clear that the man in that position was doing nothing for men.
Well, I hope you're right, and I hope you can trust the British public more than I do. Now, in my experience,
the British public are quite good at complaining. Please remember the student Rydens. Those were over news for weeks.
Yeah. I mean, the students were. I think it was in. I don't remember in which town it was. When it was that piece of legislation about squatting, the member of the parliament went to a campus to talk about that piece of legislation, and the mobster of anarcho-communists came in there and they complained in a very violent manner, and the media just simply ignored the issue altogether. But I think you have a point, Oz, that it's still good that they can complain.
Yes, we're not quite in an Orwellian state.
Not yet, anyway. Okay. I mean, now the legislation about perceived sexual danger that we talked about last week, and all those cameras in the big cities. I don't know.
Next general election, either we're going to end up with George Orwell's dark nightmares coming true, or hopefully we'll have sane people in charge.
Well, I hate to sound grim, but I would think the former is more likely than the latter.
Yes, but we can be hopeful.
I mean, talking of Orwell, immediately made me think of the EU's plans to ban anti-feminist speech. I mean, really, a most extraordinary thing. And I know you've had a piece printed in Sweden, Lucian, I think, haven't you?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm not aware that, certainly in the UK, I can't speak for anywhere else, but in the UK, nobody has brought to my attention a single piece in the mainstream media about it. It doesn't interest people. It's you know, even right-of-center journalists, it doesn't seem to bother them. I think part of that, the lack of understanding or the lack of interest among people who are particularly well-off and right-of-center, our suspicion is that particularly men who are high up the social ladder don't tend to suffer personally too much or suffer less from feminism. I guess their money insulates them. And they are also, people who are right of center tend to be innately more deferential towards women, I think. It's part of the chivalry and, you know,
it's constant deferring to the vajayjay.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you are correct on that. Now, what shocks me even further is that all the mentions about that EU's proposal are basically citing my article on avoiceformen.com or my article on Dispatch International. No other, even smaller news venues that took the news are citing one of the two articles, both of them written by me. Now, what I don't understand is how come nobody noticed that it's not only about anti-feminism. I mean, there's a whole range of politically incorrect thoughts that are deemed inappropriate by that law, and if a child dares to express them, the child can be sent to rehabilitation camps. And how much more like Soviet Union can it get until someone dares to speak up? If you look on the internet about that piece of legislation, you will find the links from the European Parliament and various versions of my article translated in Finnish and German or in English, just taken over and linked in there as well. What else should we do to just people wake up on this?
I actually think that one day a major publisher is going to realize that if it gets a top flight non-fiction writer to write an absolute blockbuster about this, it'll be a bestseller. And you know, it's been nearly 20 years since Neil Linden's excellent book No More Sex War. But you know, some publisher at some point will do this.
Well, frankly, I would love to see a dystopian movie made. I don't know, to happen in let's say 2050, after 20 or 30 years of this piece of framework for promotion of tolerance being applied, and how the society looks in there. I would love to see a dystopian movie about that, with the action happening, I don't know, in Sweden preferably.
Well, we already have it in Sweden.
Yeah.
Yeah, we can see it on live, unfortunately. Yeah,
if you give it 50 years, we'll all be living in caves. And I'm guessing a Swedish winter in a cave won't be much fun.
Mm. Yeah, well, there was a UN report talking about how Sweden might become a highly third world-like country in less than 25 years. And the UN report was published 2 months ago, and 3 weeks later it was no longer available on the internet. I wonder why.
Yeah, I think you know, with the private sector committing suicide, I think it's a very bleak future. And you know, corporation tax receipts are going to go down, So, you know, governments won't have so much money, but you can bet they will preference women in the benefit system more than men. So, it's going to get a lot worse before enough people see it, I think, quite frankly. I'd love to say, you know what, it's all going to be over by Christmas, but I think we're in for a hell of a tough battle, and there will be violence. I hate to say it, and it's something that the guys from the Voice of Men I know came in for some criticism on one or two blogs recently, but their warning, you know, I agree with their warning. You know, men will not, you know, take it indefinitely. They've taken a hell of a lot for a hell of a long time, and yeah, well, you know, it's
can
it's,
I jump it, it in here, please? Sure.
Please do.
Yes, thank you, Mike. Maybe on a more positive note here, what do you think it would take, or what do you think the men's movement could do to avert something like this from happening?
I don't think it can really. I mean, the only thing that I can think of is the political route of, you know, of attacking marginals, which will hopefully force male issues onto the political party's agendas. I can't honestly. I mean, that's what I'm driving for. The men's right movement doesn't historically have a great record of grassroots activism, does it? I think there are reasons for that, but I think that's changing. You know, the University of Toronto recently was very, very encouraging. It seems to be kicking off in Canada for some reason. I'm not quite sure why Canada, but it is. I think there are good signs. I mean, I'm very encouraged by the interest at the university level of young men, 18-year-old men, forming men's groups. I think that's an absolutely outstanding development.
I've got something to add to the conversation.
Please.
Yeah.
I mean, we're already beginning to see this this push change underground. It's a cultural movement that is blowing away from feminism and more in line towards humans being seen through the same lens. But I think what is really going to change this is won't so much hinge on anything violent, although I'm sure there will be spats that do crop up depending on where you live. I think most of the change is going to come as a direct result of male reproductive control. I don't know if anyone is interested, but for those who have subscribed to the Vassal Gel newsletter, they've just gotten done with their studies on rabbits, and they were very successful in the reversing of the Vassal Gel procedure. And their next study is going to be using baboons. After that, they move on to humans and get FDA funding. And a lot of the money isn't coming from pharmaceutical companies or anything like that. It's coming from out of the pockets of people like you and I.
Yep.
And once men have established the ability to control their own reproduction, that spells the end for anybody that wants to use men nefariously, because they can very simply get a procedure done, even if it's through black market means, and then refuse to supply the next generation of labor for that particular area.
No, I think that it's going to completely change the power dynamic. One of the things that amazed us, James, was that one of the areas that's got the most, that's attracted the most vitriol from feminists has been our proposal to introduce compulsory paternity testing at birth. They've gone crazy about this. They have gone crazy. And they say, well, very rarely happens, and it happens all the time, and we know it.
One child, yeah, in every single classroom in Britain has a different father than what he thinks the father is. Now that's not very rare in my book.
No, Lucian, it's a lot more than that. I mean, we're inclined to think it's somewhere between 20% and 30%. But the point I make to them was, you know, a paternity, you could probably get a reliable paternity test done for somewhere between £50 and £70. But it wouldn't take too many months, would it, before we kind of knew what the figure was?
Yeah.
But it's a nightmare for feminists. It's a nightmare for women who decide that they want a child even when their partner doesn't. And we know that women fail to take the contraceptive. You know, there was a Daily Mail journalist, Liz Jones, who recently did a piece about how...
encouraged this kind of behavior.
Well, I'm not sure she was encouraging it, but she was saying, look, this is totally natural. When women get to a certain age, they get desperate. And she had two partners who didn't want kids. And with both men, she used the contents of their used condoms to try and get pregnant. But certainly frustrating contraceptive methods. But I mean, men are just so gullible. They really believe. I mean, I think Judgy Bitch did a wonderful piece on this. That I mean, you know, men are so trusting. they almost have to be saved from themselves.
Yep. Okay, we're going to move shortly to a music break. We have another caller on the line. We'll bring him on the closing thoughts part of the show. I'll ask everyone to stay on the line because I'm going to pass the mic as usual to everyone. For the music break, we're going to listen to a Hungarian band called Obsidian Shell. We're going to listen to a song from the album Elysia. The name of the song is Nectared Alum, Broken Dreams. So Obsidian Shell, Nectared Alum. right, we have listened to Obsidian Shell Nectared Alum. We are here with Mike Buchanan, the president of the political party, UK political party Justice for Men and Boys. We're also with Hoofnagel, Iron John, and Oz. We're into the closing thoughts part of the show. So I'm just going to start passing the mic, starting with Oz. Oz, final points regarding what we talked about tonight.
Well, it's not quite what we talked about today, but it's been mentioned by the guest. One of the biggest problems I think you'll be facing is not actually getting people to believe in your party or actually getting media coverage. It's going to be getting people that do understand what you're trying to make and the difference you're trying to make to actually come out and vote. The majority of people I know that are young don't actually vote, nor do, in fact, the majority of people I know. Also, the majority of people I know, yes, I know I'm going on about majorities, tend to believe that when I brought up the anti-feminist speech bill being a bad thing because of also the other stuff it includes and feminism is a one-sided ideology, they've always said, good, it shouldn't be allowed to be criticized because what kind of misogynist would question the equality of just women? Other than, I don't know, humanists, secular humanists, any sensible, sane person, anyone that supports left or right-wing politics. So, yes, everyone. It should be equality for everyone or just the rich. Personally, yeah. I'll let you vote between those two options.
Yeah.
That's really quite a sad piece of news that you're bringing to us, Oz. I mean, I guess that tells something. Now, when in the small email exchange that I had with Mike before this show, he asked me whether some other mainstream media picked up on the piece of news that I wrote, and I said no, only a portion of the Swedish media took the story, and basically I wrote it for them. But I was Googling and see what are the people talking about in the forums, and what particularly surprised me pleasantly, and I know it sounds weird to be pleasantly surprised by people cursing me, is that even though they didn't like my tone, you know, that's the main objection, but their tone, but my tone, but misogyny, oh, fuck that. They didn't like my tone, but they understood that I was right. And probably, I mean, Mike is on the side of let's be calm and let's be rational and let them blow their heads off trying to discredit. Now, that certainly seems to be a good tactic, at least in the UK, but on the European stage, I guess AVFM's approach in the more FTSU manner sounds more efficient. I don't know. Iron John, final point?
My final point is not a question, but it's a statement, and it's for Mike, and I would like to say thank you. I have been listening to your appearances on the BBC, and I have to say it takes a lot of guts to do what you do, to walk literally into the lion's den and to challenge the beast to its face, and I just want to encourage you to keep doing it. There are a lot of people listening. They are counting on you. Please continue, no matter what the pressure is.
John, I'm humbled and honored to hear you say that. That's very kind. And I plan to carry on doing this to my dying day, whenever that might be. So.
Mm-hmm. All right. Hoofnagel, you have again been too silent.
Oh. I must have enjoyed the very interesting conversation, and I'm really thank you for Michael for being our guest, and I wish him a very good future, bright future for him and for the party.
Now, how long do you think it will take until we're gonna have a similar political party here in our area, Hoofnagel?
In our area, 20 years at least, or 40, probably. I don't know. Yeah.
Well, I hope you're wrong with that 40 years figure. I mean, I'm not sure that I'm going to live that much longer, so
yeah.
I'd love to die after seeing it happening, to be honest with you. Now, with that being said, my final point would be and this is for everyone listening to us right now, I think it is a good point that is valid in every single country on this planet, and it is a point that Mike constantly does, and that is the fact that the overwhelming majority of the taxes are being paid by men, and this is a fact. You cannot deny that. So I think a piece of rhetoric to be used against the gynocentric state would be, now wait a minute, we're going to pay them the overwhelming majority of the taxes so we can have those money used overwhelmingly against us? Now, how's that making any sense in a normal society? That's a point I would encourage everyone to use in their own countries, in their own areas, because I'm pretty sure that it's true in every single area on this planet. How has that been, by the way, even though we were on the edge of the show, but how has that been working, Mike, that point with 72% of the taxes being paid by males or something like that? It was in your documents.
Yeah, it's something that men certainly respond to, because they're kind of startled by it. But you know, I mean, feminists, of course, just discount it. But I'd just like to go back to that point, if I may, about, if you like, question of style, you know, how different people are doing different things. I mean, I guess I'm, you know, I sort of have the style I have, and it's calm and so on. But I think the media is not, you know, the mass media is going to pay attention to things like demonstrations on the street, on stuff like the University of Toronto. And I think that's going to kick off. I don't think, you know, the cat's out of the bag and it's not going back in again. And I might just one final thing. I said to James on his show a couple of weeks ago, the one that was broadcast at the time of that wonderful University of Toronto rally, that I thought AVFM had its finger on the pulse of the men's rights movement. And I've been thinking about that since, and I think that was rather a poor metaphor. I think A Voice for Men has become the beating heart of the movement. And it'll be fascinating to see how AVFM develops going forward. I just think your analysis on so many areas is just so sound. The materials that you put out are just so fascinating. And there's a kind of a growing consensus, isn't there, about the analysis. I think even 4 or 5 years ago, there were so many disparate analyses of various things. But I sense just on A Voice for Men, it's kind of like there is a coming together, isn't there, of what the problem is, how we defend ourselves, how we go forward. It's fascinating time for men's rights.
Not yet, but I mean it is indeed more and more cogent than it used to be 3 or 4 years ago. I wouldn't go as far as to claim an increasing consensus. I mean there would be. There still are, and there will be in the future, a lot of people who disagree with your analysis regarding AVFM. Now, frankly, I would just want to say thank you for your kind words on behalf of the AVFM staff.
AVFM have been very supportive, but I've learned so much. I mean, not a day goes by without me learning something from an AVFM piece.
Yep. Well, with that being said, I think we're going to have to call it night now. We won't be having an episode of The Voice for you of The Voice of Europe next week. So our next episode will be 2 Fridays from now, November 1st. Now, I'm not sure whether on October 25th there will be a replacing show broadcasting something. It's a little bit of a surprise. You're going to see announcement on the main site soon. But what it is sure that is that we will not be having the Voice of Europe episode next Friday. Now, with that being said, thank you, Mike, for coming to our show, and I wish you good luck, and I hope you win at least a couple of seats in the Parliament, and I hope you will be starting to make a difference in how we call it here, realpolitik. Now, I really, really hope you will succeed in that.
That's very kind, Lucian. It's been a real pleasure being on tonight.
Okay. Hufnagel, do you have a piece of advice for our listeners?
Yes, I have. Take the red pill and join our show next week.
Okay, take the red pill. Goodbye, everyone.
Join AVFM Radio Director James Huff and AVFM News Director Robert O'Hara every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Central for A Voice for Men News and Activism. This is the weekly radio show that brings you news from the front lines of the men's rights movement, along with interesting and important guests. Come and get your weekly dose of news and commentary about what's going on with the state of men and boys all over the world and what's being done about it. Listen every Tuesday night at 8 p.m. Central Time. Time for waiting on the sidelines is over. The time to act is now.
Hello, this is Fetal Bogan. I don't like feminism, and I'm not shy about saying so. I don't want to argue or debate with feminism. I want to put it out of business. And on the Counterfeminist blog, I discuss 1,000 ways, both large and small, to make this happen. Point your browser to counterfem.blogspot.com.
This has been a production of A Voice for Men. Lucian Valsan and his guests thank you for listening to The Voice of Europe. A Voice for Men radio is not corporate media and everything runs on donations. So please consider visiting avoiceformen.com and make a donation. We would also like to thank the artists De Prima Terra, Mbezna, Christian Buika, the Iranian band Arshames, the DDG Project, and all the other artists that offered us their songs to use under Creative Commons license. Special thanks go to www.eacdv.com/sound for putting the sounds of the jingle at our disposal. We would also want to remind the listeners to take the red pill. Thank you for listening to us and have a great evening. Ați ascultat Vocea Europei.